Welcome to Useful Idiots. I'm Matt Taibbi.
And I'm Katie Halper.
Do we have a good show this time?
This time, like every other time, we have a good show, yes.
All right, and we have, who's going to be on?
Abby Martin, amazing journalist, visual artist also, who's going to talk about her premiere documentary film, which is excellent.
Yeah.
And
Gaza Fights for Freedom. It's amazing, freedom, yeah. So that's going to be fun. A lot of bizarre things happened this week, so let's just do the four food groups. Yep. I guess it's me, right? Republicans?
Yeah.
A theme that I've been interested in lately is the increasing number of Republican blackface stories. It just seems like you can actually run a search, and pretty much every other week now there's one of these. There's like a subgenre of like Republican politicians who figured out new ways of dealing with this phenomenon. So this is interesting. Republican candidate for sheriff preemptively released a photo of himself in blackface, and it's this guy who says,
to be fair, some Dems do that too, but you're right, the Republicans
the original blackface thing was in Virginia,
right? Yeah,
yeah, exactly. But now we're spread, you have the Canadian one,
yeah, right, you got, where, so right, Aladdin
Trudeau
face.
He's Aladdin face, yeah. But now I think they're beginning to do it in order to get votes.
Right, like they can't win unless they have the blackface.
Yeah, exactly. In other words, they're doing it in order to get the backlash so that they can, yeah. So a Republican sheriff candidate in South Carolina is trying to own up to his mistakes. But critics say he's missing a key component, an apology. In a campaign ad posted Tuesday on Facebook, Craig Stivender, who is running for sheriff of Colleton County, South Carolina, lists off his perceived faults. A ticket for driving without a license, getting divorced and remarried, fender benders that were his fault, and losing his temper at work. But then he transitions to something a little more controversial. He went to a party dressed in blackface, and it turns out he went to a Halloween party dressed up as a local drug dealer named Demetrius Big Meech Flannery, and he released the photo and everything, and then he basically didn't apologize. He affirmatively non-apologized.
Right. It's just like, I just want you to know, FYI.
Yeah, exactly.
Up.
So this was a non-scandal that he turned into a scandal. Right.
What if it was fake? What if he didn't even do that and he created this?
Would that be worse or better?
Both.
Right? Yeah. Right? It's complicated.
It's complicated. Right? Yeah.
Like, I don't know how I feel about it.
Yeah, that would be great, though. Like, people pretending that they had these things in their past just to drum up popularity.
Right?
Yeah.
Or should we not? I don't know.
Well, no. For us, it's different because we're not running for Republican sheriff.
Right.
Contrary to popular belief.
Right. Yes, exactly. Yeah, we're not.
I gave up that dream. I was so close to doing it, though. I was so close to enlisting in sheriff school and becoming a Republican.
I could see you as a sheriff.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. There's a new sheriff in town.
Yeah. So there's that. There were actually several blackface scandals just in the last couple of weeks. But that was the worst one. That was the most interesting.
So Democrats suck. Where to start? Let's see. We have Hillary Clinton suggesting that Tulsi Gabbard is being groomed by the Russians.
It's funny. As soon as that happened, all these people on Twitter started saying, "You've got something for Democrats suck next week."
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's exactly. Funny, yeah. It was like the instantaneous reaction. Yeah.
I think they've got their eye on somebody who's currently in the Democratic primary and are grooming her to be the third party candidate. She's the favorite of the Russians, and that's assuming Jill Stein will give it up, which she might not, because she's also a Russian asset.
Also a Russian asset. Tulsi Gabbard responded, Betsy, you, the queen of warmongers, embodiment of corruption, personification of the rot that has sickened the Democratic Party for so long. It's now clear that this primary is between you and me. Don't cowardly hide behind your proxies. Join the race directly.
But I want to give credit to so many more people.
Okay.
It's not just Hillary. We have a lot of people who said terrible things. You got this woman, Jess Morales Rocchetto, who used to work for Hillary Clinton. When Tulsi Gabbard defended herself, which is extremely fair. That's a fair thing to do, right? When someone calls you that. This woman, Jess Morales Rocchetto, goes, "This sounds like a really poorly written spy thriller. Is this how she really talks? Also, lol." The also and the lol are all caps. "Also, lol. This is a message from a woman who, asterisk, met with Assad, asterisk, and is a Russian puppet." Okay. That's
that was
a spy.
That was sort of like your Sydney Ember face, but your voice
yeah.
You,
blackface, Sydney Ember face.
Right, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I don't understand. That's the spy thriller novel. It's not when your boss says that someone's being groomed by the Russians.
Yeah, no, I guess not. Yeah.
I like that Hillary didn't mention who it was at first. Very respectful. Such a passive aggressive move.
I thought that was a good marketing plan.
Another one that I liked was what Brian Fallon, who used to be her communications guy, tweeted in response to Tulsi. "This tweet reads an awful lot like the Facebook content pumped out by Russian bot farms in 2016. Yeah, only so a bot perfect. Farm.
So, you call her, a Russian agent, and then she responds like, aha!
Yeah, that sounds a lot like what a Russian bot would say, right?
That's exactly, yeah.
But I love the idea that you have to be a Russian bot to say that Hillary Clinton is a hawk
right.
and corrupt.
Yeah, yeah.
Like,
you know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of the Monty Python skit with the witch. Remember that? It's from Holy Grail. They bring the witch to be stoned, and she's got like the pointy hat and the long nose. And they're about to stone her. The knight's about to stone her. And she's like, they put the nose on me.
I'm not a witch. I'm not a witch.
But you are dressed as one.
They dressed me up like this. And this isn't my nose. It's a false one.
Well, we did do the nose.
The nose?
And the hat. But she's a witch.
You know, like, that's exactly what happened when she tweets back, and that's exactly what a Russian bot would do. It's just, like, the logic is, like, straight out of Monty Python. It's hilarious.
It's just such, I mean, it's so McCarthyite. I don't know what the, and the sad thing is you have people who aren't that courageous, and I'm not a huge fan of Beto or Buttigieg. They both, one more cowardly than the other, and neither of them, I think, came out affirmatively to talk about this, but both of them were like, no, Tulsi's not being groomed by anyone. She's her own person.
Right.
Buttigieg said he wasn't comfortable with that. Yang came out. Marianne Williamson came out. That's not surprising. What is surprising is, like, there are people who are decent, who are not radical leftists. They're not outside the political mainstream, and they also get that this isn't a good thing to do.
Right.
But they're, like, Hillary, Cory Booker, who released a GIF, and Brian Fallon, and Brian Fallon and Jessica Rocchetto, they're like extremists.
Yeah, no, it's unbelievable. And the response was actually kind of amazing. David Frum says, you know, he was supposed to pretend they were not all on the same team.
About Trump. That, right? Yeah.
Anna Navarro on CNN, when both the Russians and Trump support someone, be wary. There was an MSNBC panel, and
oh my god, when she didn't deny it.
Yeah, they're like, you know, she never really denied being
and
a
Kate
Russian
Park's
asset.
Like, oh my god, yeah.
Like, wow, they can see all the light bulb going
on.
They should have a little MSNBC light bulb graphic.
Yeah,
that would be actually good.
One thing that was interesting about Tulsi Gabbard's response, I mean, she went after Hillary Clinton. She was strong. She said that she wasn't going to run as a third party candidate. She never denied being a Russian asset. That was the one aspect that was missing from her response.
Oh, you know what?
Which
wow.
you think that would be the first,
right?
You know, in the first line or two, it was not there.
And then, you know, the Brian Stelter, he was talking to Crystal Ball, actually.
Yeah, friend of the show.
And when he brings it up, he says, it feels like a disinformation situation where the Russians want this kind of disinformation. In other words, he's basically saying that Hillary being confused about this or accusing somebody without evidence, it's actually Russian disinformation.
That's great, though. That means Hillary's the asset, the Russian asset, right?
No, she's an unwitting asset. She was used by Russian disinformation. Because remember, this is kind of a recurring theme. Like, remember when the Guardian did that story about Paul Manafort meeting with Assange in the embassy,
mm-hmm.
and it, like, rocketed around the internet because that was, like, proof of the conspiracy and everything. And then, like, it turned out that the story was, like, terribly sourced, and everybody started to disbelieve it. So instantly, like, an anonymous CIA officer under the nom de plume of Alex Finley wrote a piece in Politico basically saying that the most logical explanation for what happened was that this was Russian disinformation trying to discredit the great journalist Luke Harding.
Oh, got it.
Yeah, so this is
like
a
Luke
thing.
Luke Harding, yeah, who Aaron Maté interviewed and who hung up on Aaron Maté when he asked him a question that was not very hard
to answer.
That's
right, when he figured
his book,
out
Collusion, where he can't prove that there was collusion.
Right. He's like, where's the collusion? And
he's like, just in the title. That's
right,
it.
Exactly, yeah. The other thing that was amazing about this is that first of all, this has been years that this has gone on, and this was the first time, I think, that there was a significant portion of the media public that was like, you know what, this is kind of ridiculous. Did you get that vibe?
You know why? Because she went after, remember McCarthy's downfall was he went after the army. That's when he started to lose legitimacy, sadly. No one really cared before he went after the army for being communist. And
yeah,
they
when
were
he went
like,
after all the actors,
much.
Yeah.
Yeah, no one cared about the actors, right? So my hope is that Hillary Clinton, because she went after Tulsi, who's a vet, I want this to be her downfall.
Right.
And
right.
all the neo-McCarthyite Russia gators. So we just got to get Hillary, if you're listening to this, leave the room and someone else make this into a subconscious, like, thing she can listen to when she's going to sleep. This is logical.
How many different weird things would have to happen before Hillary Clinton listened to this
You'd
podcast?
You'd be surprised. Not a lot. She's already.
It would have to be the last thing on Earth, you know. She would have to be alone on a desert island.
Yeah. With Bill Clinton.
Yeah, with Bill.
And just trying to drown him out, do whatever she can do to drown him out, right?
Exactly.
But who's another leftist vet who she could go after? Or left? Ugh, then you got the lefties who are like, why didn't Tulsi say this about Trump or Modi? It's like, yeah, I don't like Tulsi's position on Modi, but guess what? Modi didn't call her a Russian asset. When he does that and she doesn't respond, then that's fair game.
Right.
And someone else who I know, who I really think is principled, usually, on Twitter was like, I don't know if she's an asset, but she's not a good candidate. She's inauthentic. I'm like, you can go after her for that whenever you want to. I go ahead. But co-signing on this, the asset thing, just undermines all your criticisms of her.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, no, it's completely batty. And then, you know, in the same interview, she also went after
David Plouffe, right? Plouffe, whatever, yeah.
Yeah, with David Plouffe or whatever. What? How do you Plouffe, pronounce Plouffe. It? She also says Jill Stein's also a Russian asset. Yeah, yeah, she's a Russian asset. I mean, totally. They know they can't win without a third-party candidate. Then she says about Trump, I don't know what Putin has on him, whether it's both personal and financial. I assume it is. So when you go back and think about it, so third-party candidates are Russian assets, right? So Jill Stein, basically. Tulsi Gabbard, who's kind of like the middle of the road. You know, Joe Rogan, you know, independence.
Right. Anti-regime change.
Yeah, anti-war, exactly.
Anti-war,
yeah.
But like, yeah.
Bernie Sanders, who has been regularly sort of impugned as a beneficiary of, you know, the
Russian Bernie Bros.
Russian disinformation. Yeah, they're exactly. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So it's like the entire spectrum of American political thought, except for like MSNBC Democrats. They're all Russian assets.
Yeah.
Basically.
You know what? Has Hillary Clinton denied being a Russian asset? Interesting. No, she hasn't. Makes you think, doesn't it?
It does. It makes you think. Yeah. But yeah, no, and the reaction to this has been mind-boggling.
Yeah.
I wrote a piece about it just today, and like within 10 seconds, I had like a million of the sort of near-tandem trolls. Here's a tweet from Voice of Reason, which is at ChicagoKid1971. This is the perfect preemptive strike by at Mtaibbi. It has become increasingly clear over the past year that he is the true Russian asset. A cursory review of his writing during that period will confirm it. Nice going, Matt. You could have been a contender.
In what? His favorite journalist book? What could you have been a contender in?
I don't know.
This is an insane tweet that I saw. I just want to, in terms of Clinton brain rot, which refers to not hers per se, but other people around her.
Uh-huh.
We are incredibly fortunate to have Hillary Clinton refusing to concede her position of leadership within our party. By deftly exposing the posers in our primary with precision and clarity, she's proven who truly leads, and she isn't waiting on a title to lead. That's like a parody.
Yeah. She's not waiting to be invited to...
She's leading the party by criticizing Tulsi anyway.
I kind of miss her being in public life.
I miss her a lot.
It's orienting. So for Isn't That Terrible, the story I have... So it's man in Colorado caught on surveillance video discarding woman's body in dumpster. First of all, it's kind of a party foul. Like if you're going to discard a body, you can just... look around and see. And if you see this, watch this video, you
can
see.
That's that dumpster fire of a move.
Yeah. Dun-dun-dun. So the guy actually parks, and you can see their cars going back and forth. Like, you can see the headlights.
Then you see the person struggle to pull the suitcase out and throw it into the dumpster. The person closes the lid and drives off. Police say a few hours later, they got a call to check it out.
What they saw was what they thought was skin, what they thought was blood. But being this close to Halloween and stuff like that, you never know if it's, you know, real, not.
Neighbors nearby were shocked to hear what had happened.
This is way out of the norm. I mean, do you know what I mean?
This is way out of the norm.
That's not your typical dump body removal
people
method.
People around here, they never dump their bodies on camera.
Yeah, it's always like they're always chopped up or something.
Right, yeah,
like
exactly.
Off camera.
They do it discreetly.
Yeah.
You know
who you should work with? That woman who robbed the jewelry, not jewelry place, that woman who went to the skincare store.
Right, yeah, who robbed the skincare store on camera.
Yeah, they should work together.
Right.
Sounds like he's not going to be... working much though,
yeah,
outside
probably
of prison
not.
Labor.
They got him.
Yeah. They got him.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
How on earth? How could they possibly get him?
Yeah, the crack investigators in Colorado did manage to track down this person who dumped a body on camera. All my Isn't That Terribles are actually weird.
You notice how I'm not that sad? You know why?
Right. Why?
Because it's not involving an animal.
Oh right, yeah, right.
As you said. Yeah. So my Isn't That Weird. Scientists in Japan have discovered a clever way to reduce the need for using pesticides on livestock, and the evidence supporting it is pretty black and white. A study published in the Journal found that painting zebra-like stripes on cows significantly reduced attacks by biting flies, providing means of defending livestock against flies without pesticides. The study's inspiration came from past experiments that suggested that the striped coats of zebras and black and white surfaces in general attracted fewer flies than the solid black color of the Japanese bovines that were studied.
Two things jump out at me right away about this. First of all, why was somebody painting the cows? I think
where that did that happen? Yeah, why did that happen in the first place? Right.
And why did you decide to do a scientific study about the effects of painting cows to look like zebras?
Instead of cow tipping, they're cow painting.
Right, yeah. They want to paint cows to look like zebras, and then they're using science to justify it, right?
Yeah. Also, don't they in Japan, don't they make little dogs look like pandas or something? There's a lot of role animal cosplay. What? It is in Japan. Japan has a lot of traditions that are interesting that maybe sound problematic, but they're real. They're also really into flamenco, which I love flamenco.
Flamenco dancing.
Yeah, dancing music, yeah. So I'm not making this up. This is not some racist stereotype about Japanese people making dogs look like pandas.
Right.
Maybe like tigers. There's definitely some of that. We got a lot of zoological vagary on this episode.
Yeah. No.
We're really invisibilizing
also,
animals.
I love the word invisibilizing.
Yeah, that's great.
Why would you do this study? Is this to make sure that in the future you can maximize the benefit of painting your cow to look like a zebra? Like, what's the benefit of doing this study?
Well, they don't die from fly bites.
Oh, I see.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Matt, come on. It's not just a pain. Fly bites are not just an annoyance. The insects interfere with cattle grazing and feeding, increase fly-repelling behaviors like foot stamping and head throwing, and cause cattle to bunch together, which increases heat stress and risk of injury. Fly bites are estimated to cost the livestock industry billions every year.
I just love this kind of. We're gonna do a scientific study that justifies doing something funny. There should be more
of
those.
Yeah, right. We're doing a scientific study that proves that when you put pigs in tutus, they're actually much better behaved.
Yeah, you have a three-toed sloth with a clown mask on.
Oh
it's gonna
God,
be.
We should do that.
Right. All right. So that was. Isn't that weird? Right.
Isn't that weird? Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, Bernie Sanders was in town.
Yeah, and you went.
I went. I saw Amo Bernie. Do you know what song he came out to? Back in Black.
Oh, Back in Black?
Yeah, by AC/DC.
Okay, excellent. I thought he would have done Back in the Saddle.
He could have done that, but you know what else is that Nina Turner was there, who's a great speaker. She speaks like a minister.
Yeah, I've seen her on the trail. She's
an amazing speaker, right?
It's an interesting contrast with her and Bernie.
I can barely tell them apart, actually. She goes, you don't mind if I take my notes out of my Southern lady's bank trust, do you? Which is what she calls her bra.
She said that?
Yeah.
That's excellent.
And she said, she quoted LL Cool J.
Really?
She said, don't call it a comeback.
Oh, yeah,
and
okay.
She was like, I'm going to knock you out. Mama going to knock you out. The people are going to knock you out. Talking about like corruption and greed and stuff,
which is
really, really good. But yeah, he was great. He gave a great speech. And of course, the press made it look like he had a heart. I mean, basically, they should have just written that he had a second heart attack. This is one of the headlines, though, from NBC. Can I just read you one headline? Again, this is the biggest crowd, like, ever? Is this the biggest crowd ever? The biggest crowd in New York? The biggest crowd so far?
Of this campaign?
It's something historic.
It's the biggest one in New York this year.
Yeah. It beat Warren.
Okay.
It beat her. It made powwow chow out of her.
Okay.
Here's the NBC headline. Bernie Sanders struggles to rebound. Staffing strategy health. This is the article that NBC ran the day after Sanders and AOC drew the largest crowd of any Democrat running in 2020.
Oh, right. Yes, exactly.
Literally the day after.
And, you know, look, I know you're a big Sanders supporter. Yeah. I mean, I like Bernie, obviously, maybe not to that degree necessarily, but it's gotten silly.
There are people who are not Bernie fans, and this is actually this is like a nice thing to see. They're not Bernie fans, and they're like, okay, Bernie's not my guy, but this is just ridiculous.
Yeah, and it's actually similar to the Hillary Russian assets story. I think it's like a bridge too far.
Yeah, you don't have to like. Yeah, yeah, you don't have to like Gabbard to think that it's ridiculous to accuse her of being a Russian asset.
Yeah, so I think this stuff is starting to become kind of counterproductive from a propaganda point of view.
I hope so. But Bernie was great. It was very exciting. AOC was great. Tiffany Caban was there. She's great. Nina Turner, loved it. Loved the LL Cool J. So much energy. Michael Moore was there.
The actual LL Cool J show up?
No, he's a Republican, though, so it may have been bad optics. He was at one point. Okay. Doing It and Doing It is a great song. I don't know if that's the official title of it. But that would be good for Bernie, because you know how people always criticize him for saying the same thing again and again and again?
Yeah.
So that should be hit Doing It and Doing It and Doing It. That would be a great LL Cool J. LL, if you're listening to this, please let Bernie use that song. So, Big Dick Energy of the Week.
Okay.
Who do we have? We have Cory Booker because of his gif, Brian Fallon because of his tweet, Hillary Clinton because of hers, Jessica Moretto, Rocketto.
And Japanese cow painters.
Yeah, who do you think gets it?
I mean, just Brian Fallon. The answer is always Brian Fallon if he's in the field.
I thought it would have been Hillary, but she's too easy a target. Brian Fallon, yeah.
All right, we have a fascinating interview. Tune in now for Abby Martin, who's going to talk about her amazing documentary, which everybody should tune in and check out.
That's great.
Abby, so good to see you.
Great to see you. Yeah. Thank you for having me.
Of course. Well, I guess we should just get right to it.
Yeah.
How do you meet with your sub-agent, Tulsi Gabbard? Is there a drop somewhere? Like, how does it work? Do you have to leave your mailbox up and she drives past it?
Conjures us at the round table every morning and kind of gives us our talking points that we sift through, and then we kind of diversify from there and try to pretend like we're independent. But no, it works well so far. But I mean, it's kind of, getting exposed more and more.
Is there a talking point, is there like a book code somewhere that's like every fourth word in the third story of the Washington Post, right? But you have to use like a like a Tom Clancy novel to figure out where to start the code and all
and you have to do it like a matryoshka doll. That's the space.
Right.
A matryoshka doll away
from... If the nesting doll fits,
I can't even believe that.
What do you think about this?
Well, I left RT actually 2 years before the DNI report, but yet my show, Breaking the Set, was actually included in the DNI report as part of this whole like Russian propaganda effort to usurp American democracy.
Right. You caused the Donald Trump election because you covered fracking, Occupy Wall Street,
talked about Hillary Clinton, issues that... I mean, RT fills a very necessary void, which is why it's popular. And which is, the corporate media obviously fails in doing. So, yeah, it's easier, I guess, to call everything a Russian disinfo operation. But, I mean, it's just so cartoonishly embarrassing. Because if anyone knew how actually RT operated, they would know that, a lot of people have just complete editorial freedom, which is what I had. Chris Hedges, Lee Camp, a lot of people on the network do whatever they want.
Right.
But it scares them.
Can you give us, just before we get into everything we're going to get into, just a short kind of trajectory of your career? Because you've done a lot of interesting things, and I want to make sure listeners understand the arc of it.
Sure. So I started off doing citizen journalism, reporting on, I was a board member of Project Censored, which is like the largest research organization in the country that publishes a book of the top 25 censored stories every year. Then I covered Occupy Wall Street. I was in Oakland at the time, and this police state kind of apparatus just showed up in my backyard. And so I was there covering it, and Russia Today was the only network that was actually taking it seriously and covering the protests. And so I kind of became the liaison.
This is an important point. I want to stop you there because the DNI, mm-hmm. when they did that intelligence assessment, part of the whole conceit of it was, they're really harping on the negatives of American society, and you're seeing this coverage of Occupy Wall Street. There's nowhere else to get it, right? I mean, I think if there would be a lot of people who would be covering this stuff if there was an appetite for it in the corporate press.
Right, they'd be covering at places other than RT.
Right.
Like, they're sent to RT because nowhere else will let them cover it.
And they called me someone who was fomenting radical discontent for simply covering issues fast forward a year later, and I was offered Breaking the Set, which was the daily kind of media critique show, and where I was deconstructing just media propaganda. And I was an anti-imperialist journalist who kind of wore my bias on my sleeve. But again, we know that these views are not entertained in the corporate media, and so they have to just malign anyone associated with RT. And it has become so absurd, though. I mean, this neo-McCarthyist hysteria where Jill Stein, simply for attending that dinner, and she did it because RT was the only one who gave third parties a platform.
Right.
And she was like, okay, yeah. And she paid for her own way. And she went to this dinner, and now she just incessantly maligned by Neera Tanden and all these Democratic operatives as being a Putin. What did Hillary Clinton say? She said, absolutely.
Oh, absolutely.
100%.
Totally, yeah.
100%.
By the way, we have to make sure we cut in the Neera Tanden horse neighing sound from Young Frankenstein.
Oh, right, that's yeah. Because that's
reminds
part
you
of our,
that
yeah.
every time you hear her name, yeah. yeah. But so you were, before we get into the neo-McCarthyism, so you were at RT.
Yeah.
Breaking the Set.
Yes.
Then you went to Telesur to do...
Empire Files. So I left RT after 3 years before all of this kind of really came to a head, which is just fascinating to see how it's evolved. And then I joined Telesur, which is a Venezuelan, Cuban, a lot of Latin American conglomerates that started by Fidel Castro, Hugo Chavez, to kind of combat this corporate media hegemony that was usurping their democratic processes.
Right.
And unfortunately, after 3 years of working at Telesur, which we were just selling a show to, an investigative series that basically viewed issues through the lens of U.S. empire, the thing that's kind of always missing from the analysis of domestic and foreign issues. And Trump's sanctions on Venezuela shut down the ability for Telesur to pay people outside of the country,
right.
outside of Ecuador and Caracas. So,
Telesur has also it's had problems with the internet platforms too, hasn't
Absolutely.
It? Absolutely.
Yeah,
it's been periodically shut off of Twitter and Facebook.
Yep.
I can't remember which ones exactly.
No,
but
absolutely.
Had,
both. I mean, yeah. and dozens of, if not hundreds of, like pro Maduro accounts that are completely not associated with the government whatsoever have just been purged. Absolutely purged from social media.
Right.
So anyone who's deemed a U.S. enemy
right.
is just purged and just kind of drops off the face of the earth.
And I feel like not to digress on this too much, but you know, when the whole fake news controversy started coming up here in the States, a lot of people in the States didn't really care about it, but they would if they looked overseas. And you report on Gaza too. That's another place where internet sites have been kind of taken off. Some of these platforms. I mean, this is kind of the model of what the press might be going forward, right? Where these platforms, they kind of have a relationship with governments, and they just sort of decide to selectively take some things off the net, right?
Absolutely. I mean, this whole Russia hysteria and also the fake news mantra has basically been a coordinated effort on behalf of the foreign policy establishment with working with these think tanks like the Atlantic Council, who are stacked with just defense contractors,
right.
NATO, and all these things to essentially, again, like purge dissident voices online, whether it be Venezuelan, whether it be, you know, the Syrian voices that they don't like.
Right.
I mean, basically anyone
Listen
who's dissenting against.
Syrians. Yeah.
No, it's pretty outlandish. And again, this is just all done under the banner of fighting fake news and fighting Russian propaganda.
Yeah.
And it's become very ridiculous because Google changed its algorithms and you know, you've reported extensively on this. I mean, Counterpunch, left organizations and left websites that used to get traffic on the front page of Google are now completely shunned.
Even like alternate media managed,
yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
Not exactly radical leftists.
Yeah, yeah, and our but, views too. Empire Files on
course,
YouTube,
yeah.
which is 100% grassroots funded and has been for the last year and a half, is, you know, age-sensitive content bans, just mass flagged. I mean, it's just basically completely restricted online.
So now you're totally independent.
100%.
And you've been doing that since you were at Telesur.
Yeah,
since leaving Telesur.
So we left Telesur a year and a half ago after the sanctions shut it down, and now we're 100% donor funded.
You also, by the way, your Wikipedia page is, in fact, we have to have you on and rewrite it. Can we make some edits? It's full of either like very judgmental, smearish things or outright falsehoods.
Yeah, because corporate media reigns supreme. So you know, smears and slanders in the corporate media to undermine my journalism, you know, to call me a Russian agent or conspiracy theorist is basically overshadows all the other work I've done for the past 10 years.
Not to harp on this too much, but what do people at RT, I mean, there must be in the last 3 years, I know you haven't been there, but the stress of all this has got to be a pretty serious thing for people who work there, right? Because of course it's going to impact your ability to work anywhere else in the future.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah.
And you know, I mean, what do people talk about when they discuss this off the air? I mean
the FARA thing really was meant to really scare people. A lot of people fled.
That's
because
the foreign,
they didn't want to deal with the Foreign Registration Act for RT, essentially. And, you know, of course, we're not doing this to the BBC. We're not doing this to Al Jazeera. You know, they did this to Press TV as well, so kind of outright shut down Press TV. So it was very scary. A lot of people and my colleagues working at RT were extremely terrified having to register as a foreign agent. And of course they know that they're being spied on. I mean, there's probably spies working there and surveilling them and stuff like that. So it's a really ridiculous culture of fear and censorship going on, kind of self-censorship almost for RT employees right now.
Right. Yeah. That's like the scarier part of it sometimes, right? Is that it's not overt. It's not like written. Mm-hmm. You talk about this, right? I mean, at many places, it's not like they go through it with a red pen.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's in your mind. Yeah. You know, right. Yeah.
Yeah. That's very one other quick story is I spoke out on air to kind of assert my editorial freedom, which I spoke to my superior, and he was like, go ahead. And
before we wrap up the show, I wanted to say something from my heart about the ongoing political crisis in Ukraine and Russia's military occupation of Crimea. Just because I work here for RT doesn't mean I don't have editorial independence. And I can't stress enough how strongly I am against any state intervention in a sovereign nation's affairs. What Russia did is wrong. I admittedly don't know as much as I should about Ukraine's history or the cultural dynamics of the region, but what I do know is that military intervention is never the answer. And I will not sit here and apologize or defend military aggression. Furthermore, the coverage I've seen of Ukraine has been truly disappointing from all sides of the media spectrum and rife with disinformation. Above all, my heart goes out to the Ukrainian people, who are now wedged as pawns in the middle of a global power chess game. They're the real losers here. All we can do now is hope for a peaceful outcome for a terrible situation and prevent another full-blown Cold War between multiple superpowers. Until then, I'll keep telling the truth as I see it. Have a good night, everyone. I'll see you back here to break the set tomorrow.
The next day or two, this woman resigned live on air. Her name was Liz Wall. And to kind of, you know, undermine what I had done and say, no, RT is a big propaganda network. And it came out that was actually a coordinated stunt by Bill Kristol's think tank. What? Jamie Kirchick was working
Love
with her.
Man.
To launch this whole propaganda campaign to parade her around and basically puppeteer her, marionette this woman to discredit RT and discredit my kind of asserting the editorial freedom. It was fascinating because all the media bought it. She went on the Colbert Report. She went all across the mainstream media, and she's kind of known as the hero who quit life on air. And she had no story.
She had no story of
what was actually the propaganda that was controlling the narrative. She had nothing to say, actually.
So that was a Bill Kristol thing? He put her up to it, basically?
So Jamie Kirchick at FPI, Foreign Policy Initiative, which was Bill Kristol's think tank, it was the reiteration of PNAC.
Uh-huh.
And they were tweeting right before she quit saying, tune into RT, something big's about to happen, tune in. Max Blumenthal and Ron Yukalik actually wrote a really great article in TruthDig that exposes this, how she was stage managed by neoconservatives. And Eli Lake was involved.
Ooh.
And
He said I was funny once on Twitter.
And all of a sudden she just had this giant media tour lined up to discredit me and kind of go with that narrative. And
Bill Kristol,
was fascinating.
He's like proof positive. You can be wrong about like literally everything and just keep kind of like having a job forever.
Yeah. Yeah. Now he's a resistance hero.
Yeah,
who knew?
Exactly.
David Frum. I mean, who?
Oh my gosh!
Who
are
these people?
I know,
they're just
so
rebranded
gross.
Forever.
Yeah.
He had some choice words this weekend after the Tulsi thing. You just see that?
No. What did he say?
He tweeted. He basically said something to the effect of, because Trump tweeted about Tulsi Gabbard and he called Hillary crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Trump is pretending that they're not all on the same team. You know, him and Tulsi, basically. And
as if Bill Kristol's not on the same team. As,
right, I mean,
John Bolton was a founding member of PNAC, so it's
Right.
What's PNAC? I just want to make sure.
Project for New America.
Oh, yeah. They're the ones who talked about how great the invasion of Iraq would be, right?
Oh, yeah.
That was great, yeah.
Yeah, it's like John Bolton is so close with these people.
Right.
He's probably like buds with Bill Kristol. I mean, it's just unbelievable that they're trying to distance themselves from them and be like, oh, they're on a different team. No, man, you're all on the same team.
So just quickly before we move on to Gaza, what did you think about Hillary's thing last week?
I mean, look, this is, it's narcissistic personality disorder. I mean, it's really, it's an illness.
Do you think she believes it?
That's what I was wondering.
I think that she might, because she can't accept reality, she can't face reality. But then again, it's like, how could you believe it? There's no evidence whatsoever. There's no foundation built upon this ridiculous narrative
and
the neo-McCarthy hysteria. So I don't know. That's a really good question. But all we know is that she hasn't accepted any sort of responsibility or accountability about why she lost. And really, the blame lies squarely on her. Of course, you can talk about the media giving Trump countless hours and everything else, but like really Hillary was the worst possible candidate that we could have
had.
Yeah,
and that was her big quote the night of the election, was they were never going to let me win. Remember, that was the Amy Chozick's reporting about all that.
That night where they chose to blame it on Russia over pizza?
Yeah, basically. I mean, but you know, the one quote that they managed to wrangle out of that whole scene, because it's pretty unclear what the initial...
And this punching down and punching left of like Jill Stein, who is a friend of mine, and just third parties, it's like they want to perpetually trap us in this two-party system, this prison, and just perpetuate their own privilege. And it's really grotesque. It's really grotesque that you can continue to blame Jill Stein. I mean, look at how many people don't vote. The same amount of people didn't vote. Than did for Hillary and Trump put together.
Also, you saw this interesting thing where people were like, we don't need you third-party voters. You're terrible. Go fuck yourselves.
Yeah.
And then they blame it on them.
And your Russian assets.
Like, if you think that these people caused the election to go to Trump, then why are you once again shitting on them? Like, you know, you need to convince people to vote.
No,
choose a narrative.
They think that just we owe them our votes every single time, and it's like you are facilitating. Like I just saw Samantha Powers saying this, like if Jill Stein weren't in the race, we would get all the votes. It's like, no, you wouldn't though, because we didn't want to vote for Hillary. Sorry, you were overseeing genocide in Yemen that you tried to rewrite in your book. Like, let's not rewrite history, Samantha. Let's talk about what Obama was instrumental in.
If they sucked 5% less, they might get 5% more votes, right?
Or, you know, Ben Jealous, who debated Jill Stein on Democracy Now and is not sympathetic at all, was like, people, stop blaming this on Jill Stein, because a lot of the people who voted for her wouldn't have voted for Dems anyway.
Exactly.
It's not like she sucked those things away.
Well, they did exit polls about that. They've shown conclusively that it wouldn't have changed the situation.
Can you imagine? Exactly. But you know who doesn't know that is apparently like Rachel Maddow.
Right.
All of MSNBC.
No, this is the same thing. Ralph Nader is still maligned more than Bush is.
Yeah,
seriously.
Exactly. Yeah.
People have accepted him back in the fold, but they're still like, but fuck Ralph Nader.
Right.
They're like,
What is
wrong with you?
Ellen should go see a baseball game with Ralph Nader.
You know, she gave that golden chandelier or the baby carriage with the chandelier on it to Trump. You know, have you seen that obscene, ostentatious fucking chandelier, like baby carriage that was given to Melania Trump? And Ellen gave him that.
What?
So it's like they're all in this club together.
No, that's great.
Yeah, no.
We should put Trump
in it. Melania, like, drive him around in that? That'd be amazing.
It's
give it to David Vitter. You know, he has a diapers fetish.
Really?
Yeah, apparently it's a diapers fetish. So, I mean,
think, like,
we'll have
really
to make a bigger
rich
model
people
of
with
it.
Bad politics have really bizarre, interesting sex lives.
They do, If only they could run on those.
Yeah.
What a boring friend to have, George Bush. Like, why?
I know.
My God.
He's a great painter, though. Have you seen his paintings?
Oh, yeah. The one of him in the bathtub that he scrubbed from the internet. The one of him, like, naked in the bathtub with his feet. Yeah, remember that? With his, like, face. It's like this abstract one where he's, like, his face is in the mirror in the shower. He painted a lot of shower paintings before the dead soldiers.
Well, he painted
which is up
Putin.
In the Kennedy Center right
now. He painted
now.
Putin. Good. Painted Putin, yeah.
Yeah, the Putin one is good. It's got that kind of like, it's like two flat. It's like a Hieronymus Bosch.
Yeah. He likes Putin. They talked about how Putin and his dog had a dog.
Into his soul.
His soul.
Yeah.
Yeah, he saw great humanity there. So I just want to read one of my favorite responses to Hillary's insane attack on Tulsi was from Cory Booker. Cory Booker's response
to
this
was trash.
Was a gif of him going like this.
Yeah.
First of all, he looks insane, but that's his look. We've talked about this before.
Yeah,
he's
a
cannibal. He will eat you. That's one of his faces, which is why he's...
I like it. I mean,
I don't feel
negative about it at all.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what Matt said. Yeah. And Matt said he wants a president who looks like he will eat you, which is why we want him to run with Buttigieg, because he's a woodchuck. He resembles a woodchuck, so they're very kind of toothy.
And he's more aggressive lately.
Yeah.
He's got that woodland critter.
Yeah.
It's like really bad.
Right,
now,
so it's we will eat you.
Yeah, we will eat
Buttigieg,
you.
Booker 2020.
Yeah.
So he tweets this thing, right? As in, like, it's a totally gaslighting thing, right?
Right,
he responds
right.
to Tulsi's response to Hillary Clinton, which is totally fair. And he, with a gif of him going like that, as if it's like, she's crazy. Then Hillary, it gets worse.
I saw that.
You know, Dan Savage things gets better. Well, this gets worse. Hillary Clinton tweets back at Cory Booker this gif of herself from 2016, from a debate, and she's like, okay, how delusional do you have to be?
Well, first of all, it's hilarious that presidential politics is high school now.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
I mean, this is. I think even high schoolers would be embarrassed by that level of social media behavior.
Yeah,
right?
Trump, I'm sorry. Trump is terrible. He's very good at social media.
He's a great
tweeter.
He's
rolling his eyes. He's like, Hillary is Jesus. She could learn a lot from me if she paid attention. Okay, this is a debate from an election she lost, and she thinks that this is an own. she's like, haha, Tulsi's crazy. This just looks so gross and narcissistic, as you said. And I really try to avoid that narrative because it can, it's, there's so much misogyny, not right. In you or anyone who says it, but it's such a misogynist trope. But you can't really avoid it when the person is a narcissist. In fact, I'd be misogynistic and sexist to deny her that diagnosis. Yeah. Because I'd be invisibilizing her and erasing her, and then I'd have to touch the woke button.
The woke button.
It's right there.
That's just the entitlement.
It's the entitlement of like basically doing a high school like high five on Twitter, using an image from this debate that was from an election. Like this is a face where you think you're a winner and you lost to Trump. This is your face from the election that gave us Trump. Like, no, you don't get to be like, ha, ha, ha.
So, should we talk about Gaza?
So you've
got a movie out,
yes.
Gaza Fights for Freedom, right?
Yes.
Can you tell us about it? First of all, the concept of it was really, like, so when you went, what's the history of this project? Because I thought it was really interesting the way it came out, and what was the reason that you did it in the first place?
Yeah, and I have to say that this is a huge news story. It's been going on since March 30th, 2018, and virtually no media has covered it. And when they have, it's kind of been giving way too much kind of credence to the Israeli propaganda machine and diminishing the voices of Palestinians who are being, you know, targeted, killing and whatnot. So the Great March of Return popped off on March 30th, 2018, kind of in the midst of just this egregious humanitarian crisis that's going on in Gaza, the world's largest open-air prison. 2.2 million Palestinians live there, 75% of whom are refugees, and half of whom are children.
Wow.
So keep in mind, this is a war against kids. Even the UN reports that by the year 2020, there's no water. Like, water will have run out.
80% are living off foreign aid food supplies, right? Yep. I mean, it's insane.
It's insane. I mean, 25% of all illnesses are directly caused from toxic water because they can't rebuild the desalination plants. So this is a cage population who's just been relentlessly bombed and collectively punished ever since Hamas, of course, won that election in 2006. Prior to that, Israeli forces were militarily occupying it in a brutal martial law, which is still what the West Bank is under. So we were in the West Bank in 2017, me and my partner, Mike Preisner, who runs the Empire Files with me, and we filled out all the proper credentials, paperwork to get into Gaza. This is a humanitarian crisis that American taxpayers are spending $10 million every single day to sponsor these atrocities. And Ron Paz, the foreign press minister under Israel, basically outright denied me. They called me a propagandist, not a journalist. And they also called me an Iranian agent, which I thought I was a Russian agent. Yeah. That was a new one for me. I was like, am I a Venezuelan agent or a Russian agent?
Yeah,
now I'm an Iranian
passports.
Agent.
You are an internationalist, Abby, so it makes sense that you'd be working for multiple governments.
So I worked, it actually worked out really well because I Skyped into a session of Gaza journalists when the Great March of Return started, and they were just like, you know, can we work with you on a Empire Files episode about the Great March? And so I directed these interviews of victims who were being killed, you know, and this includes not only scores of civilians and children, females and males. This march is being led by a lot of women, contingents of Gazan women that you never hear from, but also protected categories of the Geneva Conventions, children, press, medics,
disabled
people. And so once I got the footage back, it was so cinematically brilliant that I thought, you know, I cannot just put together an Empire Files episode. We have to put together a full feature-length documentary film. And that's what we did for the last 8 months or so.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of it's like it was sort of really high-res, like slow-motion stuff. I mean, it doesn't look like a typical political documentary.
Exactly.
Right.
It has almost, it has like a... It's almost like Koyaan Ostatsky or one of those old, you know,
it's amazing cinematography.
People need to watch Samsar and Baraka too. That shit's so good. But yeah, no, that's what I felt. I felt like to do this justice, to really do the story justice, we had to really put the effort
into it. Because there's so many anti-war movies that are great, no one has the funding who's making an anti-war movie to have like a beautiful cinematographic film. So this was like, I have to say, I was in the movie theater. I saw it at a screening and I was like this the whole time. I was like, and I'm pretty critical of Israel, but I have to say, I was so angry, and it changed the way I saw it. Like, I now honestly think there's just like no hope. There's no hope for any two-state solution. I'm sure you were there before, a long time before that I was. But, and you know what else made me realize? Like, everyone likes to talk about how nuanced it is, shades of gray. Mm. What's so fascinating about this story is that because it's related so directly to international law, and there's a border, it's not complicated. It's black and white. Israel, and what I appreciate that you didn't, it was less polemical than a lot of things, or it could have been, but you just laid it out. Israel violates the international law this way, this way, this way, this way. You know, so it's, I feel like people who aren't that critical of Israel would could be affected by this film in a way that...
Yeah, and, you know, I have my own personal opinions about this, and going to the West Bank, seeing the atomization by settlements, and kind of seeing the impossibility of what would the two-state even be at this point. And Israeli officials have laughed off that notion, I think, since the Oslo Accords, which, you know, Elizabeth Warren, on the other hand, says that this is the official Israeli state policy for the last 7 years. No idea what she's talking about.
Well, everyone says that, but they don't mean it, right? That's just, they pretend,
But no, that, and so my opinions aside, I wanted to structure this entire documentary under just the structure of international law violations.
Right.
I mean, anyone who watches this, if you believe in if you believe in humanitarian law, if you believe in basic human rights, and if you believe in the Geneva Conventions, if you believe in the Hague Conventions, a lot of these things have been decided a century ago, decades ago by the international community. You cannot kill unarmed people who pose no imminent threat. You cannot target children.
Exploding bullets, the gas.
Oh my God, absolutely. The exploding bullets,
And
the gas things are amazing, because they spend so much time here in the States talking about the Assad incident, and they even argue about whether or not it happened,
right?
Or who did it. You have footage where literally people are like gasping, and you see it. I mean, it's so graphic.
Someone brought that
up. It's not like someone's telling you about
it. This is selective outrage that is so perfectly exemplified. The fact that, you know, the world stands in uproar about chemical weapons being used in Syria, and then they just completely turn a blind eye to the fact that there is unnamed incendiary devices, not only white phosphorus being used against Gaza civilians, but unidentified toxic gas that actually kills people, suffocates people. And this is, as we know, I mean, Israel is actually leading as one of the world's largest defense contractors at this point. And so they are using Gaza as a testing ground for these unidentified, you know, gas and different weapons, the exploding bullets. And then they'll go around to these weapons expos and brag about it and say, battle tested. Really just kind of using it on a caged civilian population.
There's also in the movie you show footage that someone shot, a soldier shot, where they're narrating shooting someone. I don't know if he dies or they just blow off his leg.
They shoot him in the head, so I'm not sure what happens.
So, and they're like, they're gleeful about it. They're laughing. They're happy.
And this is the roots of kind of violent settler colonialism, like kind of shared roots of our racist society, right?
Yeah.
And you kind of have to be indoctrinated and brainwashed to be okay with that and to kind of cheer something like that on. Like the expulsion of indigenous inhabitants, that there's an ongoing ethnic cleansing project. And in order to have a society where 83% of Israelis agree with the open fire policy at the Gaza border, and let's get this clear, this is not a border fence, this is a militarized perimeter fence that's partitioning Gazan refugees off from the lands that they were ethnically cleansed from. And this entire march was just a symbolic action.
Right.
It was literally just to call attention to their plight of refugee as refugees and pitch tents. Kind of like Occupy Wall Street. It's very like similar to what they wanted to do. The guy who led the march was just a poet.
Right.
So yeah, I mean, back to your point, is there's a very disturbing video of them filming themselves basically open fire on little children, and they're like, should I get the one in the pink? And the guy's like, no, get the little kid in the blue. And then he just shoots him, and he's just screaming in hysteria, excited at them.
Oh, look at that one.
Look at his legs flew up, and they're like, oh, film that. That's amazing. And I think they posted it in a private chat.
It's like Jackass or something.
It's
crazy.
Oh, it was a private chat?
It was a private chat, and it was leaked out of this private chat, and God knows how many more videos like this exist.
Right, we just happened to see that one, yeah.
And that's why we wanted to show intentionally, like, we felt like we did show the Israeli side, because every time that the story is covered, and it was only covered when I think 60 Palestinians were mowed down in cold blood by Israeli snipers, and again, this is a wide view of the demonstrations, and they're just picking them off one by one while they're dancing and standing there with flags, as you saw. But yeah, I mean, that is the Israeli side. The Israeli side is not giving kind of carte blanche to Israeli generals justifying these atrocities and excusing these actions. It's actually the Hasbro propaganda machine, where it's a very slick arm. You know, it's an apparatus funded tens of millions of dollars, a lot by U.S. tax dollars probably funneled into this. And it's people who look like me and you who are speaking English, speaking to an American audience to convince us that this is okay.
I mean, there was another part of the movie that I thought was really effective, where you kind of showed all of the media pronouncements of politicians and Netanyahu, and they're saying things like, oh, they want lots of telegenically dead Palestinians and everything. Kind of reminded me, and then you juxtapose that with all these scenes of like, you know, horrific, you know, graphic violence. Reminded me a little bit of Hearts and Minds, the movie about Vietnam, where you had like, you know, General Westmoreland talking about how the Oriental doesn't value life and everything, and then they're like killing Vietnamese. But I like the way, I mean, was that a conscious strategy to not editorialize that much? You just showed them, and you showed the pictures, and that's kind of enough, isn't it?
Yeah, no, Matt, exactly. And it's interesting that you bring up Vietnam, because this human shield mantra has been actually used for decades for kind of U.S. military conflicts to dehumanize the other and to rationalize ongoing violence against the civilian populations. It's been used in Vietnam. It's been used in Iraq.
That's right. They said that about North Vietnam, didn't they?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, but for some reason, I guess it's become so embarrassingly bad. That all Netanyahu really has are cartoons to kind of show, you know, this is what Hamas brings to a protest. It's like, well, why don't you have photos of this? I mean, if Hamas is bringing, and it has nothing to do with Hamas, of course, but it's like, we looked through 12 hours of footage and we didn't see one weapon.
Right, that's the thing. And as you say, if there had been one, do you know how much, like, exposure that would have gotten in the media, how much video footage, photographs, like, articles about it? So two of the pieces of Hasbara that are really related to this subject are the Israel has the right to defend itself, they all want to kill us line, and we pulled out of Gaza and look what happened. How would you respond to those?
Well, I mean, first of all, they didn't pull out of Gaza. This is what everyone says, and it's disgusting. Actually, I just saw, speaking of Hillary Clinton, the debate between her and Bernie Sanders, where she said exactly that, like basically echoing Trump's line, saying they pulled up, we gave them Gaza, and this is what they did. You know, they elected this theocratic dictatorship, or someone like Barry Weiss and Bill Maher saying, yes, they planned this. They planned their own genocide. They planned their own massacre. It's like, my God, what is wrong with you?
Don't fall for it. Just doing something.
They planned that absolutely.
I agree with everything you just said.
Oh my God.
But I mean, look, they're under a medieval siege.
Right.
So they use the justification, and you look at WikiLeaks cables as Assange is rotting in prison. If you look at these cables, it shows that Israel wanted Hamas to take over. They worked with Fatah to make that happen in 2006. So then they can regard Gaza as a hostile territory and then justify everything that they do to them.
Right, and if you give them freedom, if you give them democracy, they'll vote in these terrorists.
Yeah, that's let's be clear. I mean, the fact that water is deprived, electricity is deprived, the fact that they don't allow construction materials into this area, it's like, how are they self-governing? How are they determining their own future?
Medical treatment.
They've restricted every
you
year.
You have to get permits to get medical treatment?
Yeah. I mean, and that's so dystopian. And they're shooting a lot of these people in the knees, so they are deliberately know that they will be amputated and amputees.
It's so disgusting. Did that guy, you interview someone, Mohammed, who more time passes, more likely it is that he'll need an amputation because he's not getting a permit to go get surgery.
Yes.
Do you know what his status is?
He's amputated.
Five
centimeters every day. A lot of these people, there's a lot of more gruesome material of them saying that they, you know, the ligaments can be seen. Wounds are rotting because they can't even get proper dressings for their wounds. And again, since the protests popped off, they actually just collectively punished everyone involved, and they said everyone is a Hamas militant that's involved, and so everyone was just outright denied. And not only had, you know, the permits had been offered less and less, but then once the protests started, they said everyone involved was denied medical permits.
Another thing that I thought was interesting is that you highlighted the way, you know, there's this technique that they use with the press where unnamed sources, like usually military intelligence sources, will say something as bad is going to happen. They're planning on doing something violent, right? And I remember they happened when the flotilla happened in 2011. They're going to load up boats with sulfur and explosives, and like the whole world sort of prepped for the idea that they're going to do something bad. So then when the reaction happens, everyone's like, oh well, you know, it's all reasonable, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it seems like that's a pattern that happens there over and over again, is that they kind of seed the press with this idea, right? And then it raises the expectations, and therefore they have to be shot or whatever it is,
right? Justified.
Right. And it's fascinating, too, because even if you look at, like, that propaganda saying Israel has rights to defend itself and they're going to commit a massacre.
Right.
I mean, Ahmed, the organizer of the march, and the march was completely organized by unaffiliated academics, poets, activists, like no one that had anything to do with any kind of political organizations. And by the way, Hamas is not this monolithic entity.
Yeah.
There's a bunch of other political parties there, including leftist parties. But Ahmed explains clearly, he's like, this is a peaceful, symbolic action to try to mount international pressure. And so he kind of debunks that on its face, but it doesn't matter because they're always going to use the human shield propaganda. Right. They use it against Razan al-Najjar.
Right, who's a medic who maligned
her. Yeah,
right.
Medics raising their hands up, going toward the fence. They will never stop using that human shield propaganda. But it's so ridiculous because even if you look at the military definition of what a human shield is, it means that you're using a civilian in front of you to as an armed militant. And it's like there's no militants at the march.
Right, yeah.
So what even does that mean?
There's a scene where she tells a journalist, I'm here as a human shield, meaning I'm here as a person who's unarmed and I'm trying to protect other people to stop Israelis from shooting at someone behind me. She doesn't want to be shot.
Right.
It's like a preventative anti-violence thing, not a...
Like, oh, now you made us go and shoot you.
Yeah. It is so sordid.
And to say that they're committing self-genocide, I mean, I just can't...
Oh my God, that
I
was like when Mitt Romney said, like, self-deporting.
Yeah.
But much worse.
Yeah. It's talking points that I just can't fathom that people
believe. And even
believe.
If you also make this point, which even if they did, so the Palestinians have not done what they're accused of doing. Mm-hmm. They have not come to the border and threatened people. There's nothing came close to, like, no one came close to being killed. No Israeli was close to being killed.
Four claimed scratches from thrown rocks.
Scratches from thrown
rocks.
And
property damage.
And you say, but even if they had done that, which they very much did not, but even if they had, that actually would have been justified legally.
Right,
defending yourself.
Right, and the UN, we try to structure everything within the confines of international law. So even with the UN General Assembly of 1978, clearly states that armed struggle is legitimate and justified for people who are under siege and occupation by a foreign military, and that's exactly what is going on in Gaza. But again, like, they have abandoned this notion largely as a community of violent resistance. I mean, we saw that in the intifadas, and now that's why they're doing this mass mobilization. But absolutely, I mean, and that's the thing. What we try to prove with the movie is that everything Israel's doing under the confines of international laws is illegal and criminal, and everything that Palestinians are doing is legal and justified.
Yeah, but the media, I mean, the entire official narrative from Israel, from American media, is the exact opposite.
Well, since it's worthy on unworthy victims,
that
whole thing,
right?
Like, it's, you know, like Syria, those are victims. We can talk about that. Yeah. We can't talk about because they're. What about the reception of this? I mean, what you made this documentary? It's a great documentary. It's affecting. But if you had trouble trying to get traction with it in the West, I mean, like, what's the story there?
When's the Tel Aviv screening?
Actually, they are screening one at Tel Aviv University. I'm working with some anti-Zionist Israelis now, very few of them. But no, I mean, the traction is very little. That's why we're doing peer-to-peer grassroots screenings, working with anti-war organizations and pro-Palestinian solidarity organizations around the country, because we want to couple this with tools to action, with a call for BDS and international solidarity with Palestinians. And we don't just want people to see it on Vimeo and be sad and just kind of feel desperate. Like Sabrine, Razan's mother, says, we want more than your sympathy, we want our rights.
Right.
It's time for us to just stop being watched, being killed, and we really want our rights back. And when we say rights for Palestinians and BDS, we mean we're not kicking, you know, no one's gonna be kicked out of their homes. It just means resettlement and reparations for Palestinian refugees and lifting the siege and occupation, of course. So the reception has been mixed. I mean, in terms of venues and people who are the audience, I mean, sold out venues all across the country, venues who want to co-sponsor it. I feel like the political consciousness is completely shifting. Right-wing cities like Albuquerque, Phoenix, putting Gaza Fights for Freedom on these marquees with, like, no disruptions, no protests, no complaints, which I think 5 years ago you would have seen a bit of a difference. But in terms of distribution, it's another story. I mean, Matt, y'all know, like, Rolling Stone, this is amazing that you'll give this a platform, because this is not given a platform. Palestinian voices are not amplified, and when they are discredited by Israeli Hasbro propaganda. And so the fact that you're doing this is really monumental and huge. But you'll see that over and over again. I mean, when the 60 people were gunned down, it was passive voice. It was that they were killed or they died.
Right.
You know, who's killing them?
Right.
Or that clashes happened and 60 died.
Clashes,
it's like,
yeah,
no, they were systematically murdered.
They were died.
Yeah, they were.
Yeah. As if there's any comparable, as if it's a battle at all.
Right.
One side is like armed to the hilt and one isn't.
No, it's unbelievable. And it's like, again, a wide view of these demonstrations, and people are dancing, celebrating, and the courage that's seen by Palestinians, where you'll go up to as a rite of passage, you'll throw a rock, knowing that you can get shot in the head for doing that, or just run up to the fence and put a flag. You know, that's a symbolic act. They're not trying to do anything, and the fact that they're getting systematically gunned down in cold blood is really, really shocking. But it's not distributed anywhere. It won't be. Even PBS had a frontline documentary ready to go about the Great March of Return, and they had to pull it.
Wow.
Al Jazeera, as we know, pulled the lobby. And right. So you're seeing this happen time and again. And I think that just ignoring it at this point is easier than trying to discredit it, where I think a couple right. of years ago they would have kind of gone on the offense. But now they just think, you know, it's worth not paying attention right. to and not trying to shine a light on this film.
Can you talk about the process? Because you were not allowed to be there. So mm-hmm. what was the timeline like? They would shoot something, they would send it to you. Were you like Skyping in real time during the interviews? There was translation?
Yeah, no, this is, I totally forgot to say this part, which is we had to redact our co-producer's name, the field producer who was on the ground every day coordinating all these interviews. And I had to redact his name at the end, because he said, I can't put my name to this film because I'm scared of retaliation from the Israeli government. And if I put my name on it, I might not ever be able to leave Gaza. And so the fact that he's not with us and not given the accolades and not being able to screen these films with us is really, really disturbing to me. But yeah, I mean, I got all the footage kind of at once of the interviews, and I was so blown away. I was like, my God, the fact that you have these steady cams and the slow motion and the drone shots, and it was so unbelievable. And then I hired Maz Maza, and I have to give a shout out to Maz Maza, the main videographer at the march, who risked his life every week,
yeah.
saw people getting gunned down over and over again and ran toward the bullets. I mean, that's courage. That's something that Bill fucking Maher doesn't understand because he's a coward. So Maz Maza, I hired him again to get more footage of the march and keep sending that material.
Were you scared he was going to be killed?
Absolutely stunning. Yeah, of course. I mean, and that's the privilege as an American citizen sitting safely in yeah. downtown
but
Los
you,
Angeles.
But to be fair, you would have done that if you could have. Not
yes.
that you have to. I wouldn't yeah. have done that. But and there's nothing wrong with asking people, you know.
No, I mean, that's the thing is that, like, I have to understand my privilege and, like, use it to,
right.
to
yeah.
do everything that I possibly can to lift these voices and amplify these voices. Because how can I not fight every day to expose the atrocities that are being committed and perpetrated by my government if they're risking their lives
yeah.
every week to get this footage to show us what's going on?
People should definitely watch it.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Where can they watch it? Yes. How can they do that?
Yeah, so GazaFightsForFreedom.com. We're actually wrapping up our tour right now. You can check out the last remaining tour dates on GazaFightsForFreedom.com. But right now it's behind a small paywall on Vimeo, of course, just to recoup some of these production costs, which we paid Hollywood wages to all the Gaza journalists and, you know, basically spent the entire fundraiser that we raised for Empire Files on this film. So that's how we're going to get it more seen more places. If you're interested in a screening, write me there. GazaFightsForFreedom.com. It's on Vimeo right now, and we're going to make it more widely available after the tour.
Excellent.
Great.
Right.
Yeah.
Abby, thank you so much
yeah.
for coming.
So
really
much.
Appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, yeah.
Wow, that was amazing.
That was great.
Yeah, no, it really was, actually.
It was.
Yeah.
And you know what? Very important point to make very quickly is that what's amazing about that movie is that there really is joy among the people in Gaza. Like,
She starts off the film that way.
Yeah. You see them at the beach, and it's this amazing juxtaposition because they actually are the only people in the world who aren't allowed to flee
right.
by boat.
Yeah.
Like, most places, it's like, we don't care about you. Go die in the sea. But they can't even do that.
Right, yeah, exactly. And they're going to build a seawall.
Oh, my God, so scary, yeah. But there are these adorable kids. And honestly, I'm surprised there isn't more violence.
But
from the Palestinians, I mean.
Well, when you watch this movie, you'll be amazed that there's such a total blackout on this story
yeah.
in the United States. And I felt kind of ashamed that I didn't know more about it.
Don't blame yourself. Blame the Hasbara. That's the Israeli propaganda.
Okay, I
yeah.
blame them. All right,
yeah.
excellent.
Oh
well,
God,
anyway, tune in. Check out the documentary. Thanks for listening to Useful Idiots.